Welcome to Pull Hook Golf, the podcast, hosted by Matt Cook and Mike Perez.
And we are back. Episode number 6, Mikey Perez. I still don't know how we got through 5 episodes already. I mean, my God, you and technology, it is a thing of goddamn beauty. And tonight we have a very special guest on. He played 14 seasons in the NFL. I mean, we're going to just an incredible golfer as well. So yeah. As I understand it, a plus 2, just striving for every accolade you can get. So without further ado, Mikey, why don't you let us know who our guest is tonight?
Our guest tonight is the one and only Derek Anderson, who does care. So we're going to give Big DA a good shout out. DA,
sure,
we know you care. And we appreciate, you'll be hearing that a lot this episode. And we do appreciate you taking the time to join us on our Pull Hook Golfcast. Golf podcast, that is, and
I love it, Mikey. Fun. You're still getting there, absolutely.
Have some
now,
fun.
Tonight, we are going to cover some topics, all different types of topics. We're going to talk a little bit about the NFL, your career a little bit, Derek, and then from there, we're going to dive into some golf topics. So we're going to get into the LIV Invitational Tour and everything going on there and how that kind of correlates to other sports and free agency and how the dominoes are starting to fall. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the celebrity golf tours, get your take on those, what you're going to be doing coming up, if you have any plans around that. And then lastly, we're gonna dive into good old Mikey Perez on the comeback trail. I mean, everybody was just floored by Tiger Woods coming back from a cracked shin.
Don't get old.
Mikey Perez had a knee replacement, folks, and he's just what, 6 months back from
6 months? Sorry, like 6 months?
I don't know. That's what you told me.
It's been January 21st since I had the operation.
There you go. Wow, that's quick.
Out of the game, I would say pretty much 6, yes.
Yeah, so Mikey Perez made his cut in his first pro tournament back, so we'll be talking about that. But let's start off with that 14-year career in the NFL, DA. I mean, tell us, what is it like to be a quarterback in the NFL? Like, what is that mindset playing that many different seasons, having that many different coaches? I mean, it must be just a wild experience.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of just tell people if they actually knew what on day to day over the course of the years, they might not watch the games. But it was a great ride. Met a lot of great people, had a lot of fun, maybe too much fun at times. But I saw some cool cities. Like you said, I had a ton of coaches, ton of great teammates, lots of great experiences, and miss it dearly to this day.
I bet. Did you have, like, as far as, I don't think people understand what, during the training in the coach's office, the book that you have to read to know all the plays and all that stuff. That's got to be, what's a ballpark range of how many plays, like, you have to know while trying to read the defense and all that stuff?
I counted it one time. We had something like 336 different plays on a play sheet during 1 week.
No wonder why Winston always just ran the ball.
I mean, you got to really, like, especially like now, you have code words right and left for, let's call it, 30 runs during a game. So there's 60. You know, obviously 60 plays, you know, right or left that you got to kind of remember, plus all the, you know, 2-minute stuff, no huddle stuff. It used to be kind of frowned upon, guys using wristbands. I know early on in my career, one of my coaches was like, yeah, wearing a wristband in practice. I'm like, pal, I'm in my first year here. I'm trying to make sure I don't screw the cat.
You know, and, hey, right.
So he makes me take the damn thing off during practice, and I fuck the whole thing up.
Really? You take it off even though it was benefiting you and helping you and the team?
Well, he thought it was the more beneficial thing was for me to struggle in practice and then give it to me during the game to, you know, so it was a cheat sheet during the game. But then I already knew what was going on, what was coming. And to be honest, he was right. You know, 2 years later, I finally realized, I'm like, okay, it trains my mind. So like when he's calling the play, I already know what he's calling as soon as he says the formation.
Gotcha.
So then it eventually turned into, because we had a coach that couldn't communicate the play. You would cut things out, and not to throw anybody under the bus, but I'm not sure it got lost in translation. But so then we got a wristband. He would just go flip number 66, and he'd go in the wristband and look at it. Like, oh, okay, 66. Well, now you got to be smart enough, or maybe not get in the head a few times before you look at it. You got to figure out how to flip it. So you got to remember all the words and all the flip words.
Oh.
Early on in my career, it was a struggle. But as things went along, you know, the last season in Buffalo, I was only there for 8 days or whatever and started the game. And
I remember.
Played like a clown, but, as far as the operation and getting the plays off and do all that, I somehow made it.
You were on downtime. You were on downtime for a while, too, because I remember you told me. You said, yeah, Buffalo.
Oh,
I mean, I was, you weren't expecting that.
I was on, and this is no joke, I was on about 20 of these on a golf course with some
shocker,
fouls.
Yeah.
And he called me, and I was like, I'm not going to lie to you. I've had a few drinks. I might want to call you back tomorrow. Let's have a chat about this.
Even though he already knew the answer was going to be yes.
I mean, right. I wasn't ready to get – I was on a trip. It was we were playing the club championships. So, like, four best guys from every club in Oregon go to play, like, a club champion deal. So I was there with three other guys, and we got hammered on the golf course. We got roasted on the golf course. And then that next night I was like, screw it. We have no chance of winning this thing. So I might as well just go have some drinks. Indeed. But that was kind of how that whole thing went along.
Now, is it that big, much of a difference making the transition from when you played for the Beavers and into the NFL? Was it like a...
Yeah. I mean, honestly, like the verbiage was kind of an issue early on where it was, you know, I wasn't used to having to do all the flip the formations and, you know, make sure in college, I honestly didn't do enough to help us. I realized that later on, like I should have been able to, you know, orchestrate things a little bit better. Mm-hmm. And I learned that in my like first, you know, 6 weeks out there, I was like, oh, okay. And then coaches yelling at me, you got to make sure he's set. And I'm like, well, that's his job.
That's his job.
That ain't my
job.
Yeah,
exactly.
I told him what to do already twice.
Right. And then, I mean, exactly.
I mean,
that's his job.
I mean, just that transition, I think, was harder for me than it was playing, so to speak. Like, the playing part was, it was fast, like the first couple of games.
Sure.
It was fast. And then I just kind of got jumped right in. Like, my second year, the first game, Charlie Fry started. He made it through the first quarter, and they traded him to the Seahawks in the third quarter. I'm not kidding. But they traded him out.
I
totally was, yeah. Yeah, well, he knows I know so much about sports.
Yeah.
I mean, he knows
traded him after the game, and I went on and I started the next 15 games. And that was my biggest stretch that I played going into that. Like, I played two games at the end of the year before and blew my shoulder out. And
I don't remember.
Kind of was so I didn't really get to play a lot. So I think the transition for me wasn't as hard as, you know, like I said, the playing part. It was more the mental aspect and organization of how to kind of get guys going in the right direction. I guess maybe just leading guys, like just another layer of that kind of help.
Sure.
What was your favorite organization that you played for?
Darius. Yeah, great question.
Probably Carolina.
Yeah.
I mean, I was there 7 years. My kids were born there. All the highlights of my career. I went to the Super Bowl there. I'm kind of my closest buds that I, you know, still talk to are from those teams. But honestly, like Buffalo was, I mean, I was only there for a year, but I freaking love that place, man.
People are different in Buffalo. I'm an upstate New York guy, but those Buffalo guys, those are weird guys. Like, not weird, but they're just animals out there.
Sundowner.
It's insane.
As we all drink, because it's Buffalo.
Sundowner.
I mean, I go, I first get out there, my family didn't come with me. I just rented an apartment, and they came out for home games, and really enjoyed the fact that you just drive down the street and every four corner stop, there's a bar on each corner. It's unbelievable.
Get a roadie there.
Go on there and you can get like some of the greasiest wings, or you can go down to the next one and get some. I mean, they got wings everywhere, pizza everywhere.
It's all things to stay warm.
I had this little apartment. What's that?
I said it's all things to stay warm because it's freezing there.
Oh, yeah, it was fantastic. But I wish I could have spent at least another year there. I really did enjoy the madness of the Bills Mafia.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, it probably felt good just to get back in the action again, huh? Just get back in the action. I know you're very competitive.
Until I woke up on Monday morning.
Yeah.
I go from chasing the white golf ball in the weeds the week before and then wake up the following Monday and I can't stand up. I was like, I might be getting a little too old for this.
It was that quick.
They signed me. I was playing golf. They signed me on a Monday. I flew out, signed, go to the game that Sunday, and Josh tears his UCL getting hit. And the other guy goes in, doesn't play very well, and coach is like, hey, what do you got for me this week? And I was like,
let's go.
I got you. And I just went out there. I gave it everything I could. I was not as in good shape as I probably needed to be, and I took some gnarly hits early on, and my back just locked up like crazy. This dude hit me with his forearm, like, square in the back, and I came in at halftime. I'm like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to finish the game. Oh, it was so bad. I was like, I'm getting too old. You know, this is nuts. But I played that week, and then the following week, in Monday night game against the Patriots, and actually played pretty good. I ended up pulling one of my favorite tricks, hit a guy in the chest to let him go the other way. It was a good you know, it was a good run. And I had a lot of fun. It was just a bummer that's the way she ended.
Was it only a year deal? I don't remember.
I went out there like week two or three, whatever it was.
Okay.
And then I actually re-signed to come back the next year, but I finished that last game. I got a concussion, and it was a mess. My ears rang for like 6 months.
Oh, my gosh.
Just all this crap that one day I was like, I got three kids, man. It's time. I can't go back. And they gave me an unbelievable opportunity to actually go back and not have to worry about all that stuff. But at the end of it, I was like, I wouldn't feel right, you know, going back and being on a team essentially that I really was never going to play.
Sure.
So I just said, let's just pull the cord and
start
having some drinks and playing some more golf. So
There's nothing wrong with that. I love having some drinks and playing some golf.
I got bored really quick, I promise you that.
Your health at that point, though, when you're starting to go through that, I can only imagine what goes through your mind, because that's got to be a tough, you know, give up. You know, tough give up. You dedicate your whole life to football.
Once I was still in, you know, pretty good shape, I could still throw it.
Yeah. Like, play a catch.
You can have a catch anytime you want. Matt, we went and had a catch once.
And I go, come on. Bring it. I go, really, just, you know, bring it. Boy, did I pay for that.
Yeah, did you have a broken nose? Oh, you hit him in the chest.
Oh, hit me right. I mean, it came in perfect. We were just having a catch. I'm like, come on. We were drinking.
See, he was being nice to you, though, Mikey. No, that could have come right at the nose.
No.
Ben just
asked. Oh, he went
just
do that.
A blood fest on that one.
No, he would not. He wouldn't pull a mox on me.
We had one the other day at a member guest having a catch. We're having a catch. Guy catches it. Whole finger comes out and is down here. And his ring is stuck on his finger. Luckily there was a doctor there. The dude
at Silverleaf. I'm shocked.
It's a member guest, so there's a doctor there.
Right. And he pulls it and back in place. It was almost coming out of his skin. It was so nasty.
Oh, that's
just having a catch, Mikey.
Just a normal catch? Did you really give him you didn't bring the heat like you brought
it? I didn't throw it. Another
quarter. Man, I was in so much pain because the first couple catch when we were playing catch, that's.
Now I want the truth here, DA.
Catch.
Did you throw it 100%, or was that like 75, 80? I mean, give me a range.
It was a good hummer.
It was a good hummer.
It wasn't probably full gas, but it was for not being warmed up, it was a pretty good heater.
It was a good one.
So I'll say it was 90%. I'll give you 90%, Mikey. How about that?
Oh, at least. Yeah. I'll take 90.
Did you at least have your hands up, like, ready
to catch it? Yeah, I caught it.
But it just went right through your hands.
Your lungs caught it.
Oh.
Yeah, Mikey, you do understand you're supposed to catch the ball with your hands, right?
Well, I understand that. But where he threw it, I had to go a little this way, and it hit me here. And I just remember going, oh, good catch. Go get me a drink now. You broke my freaking ribs, lungs, everything else. It was a great heater, though. You know, I want to bring the heat.
And he brought it. Not even
I
want to
bring
up,
the gas.
Like...
What's a bull there? I'm saying I want to bring the heat.
Give him the heater, Ricky. Isn't that what he says?
Something like that. I'm trying to remember. Come on, meat. Come on, meat. Give me the heat.
Somebody will fact check us.
Meat. Yeah, he calls him meat.
Get it right.
I am sick and tired of you fucking calling me meat. But Maddie, that was some kind of catch. That's what we always joke.
Some kind of catch.
Well, no,
it sounds like it caught you. You didn't catch it.
No, my whole body caught it. But the funny thing behind it is, you know, how people say, "Hey, you want to go practice? Want to do this?" So we say, "When are we going to play catch?" You know, and people are like, "What are you talking about?" I go, "Let's go play catch. Me and Dan, we're going to go out and have a catch in the middle of the day and go have a catch." Yeah, go have your lungs.
My cousin uses it now. He says, "We want to go have a practice.
Have a practice.
Let's go hit golf balls." He says, "Let's go have a practice.
Have a practice. Have a catch."
I like it.
Yeah, have a catch. Have a practice.
Absolutely.
So, that was a hell of a catch. That's just the term. Let's go have a catch.
Well, going from a football story to a golf story, I mean, I know for our podcast listeners, you don't know what's behind us in terms of our background. If you haven't checked out the YouTube channel yet, definitely check it out for the visual effect. But the golf course behind us is a golf course up in Oregon, which was formerly, I found this out today, was formerly called Sand Pines, but now it is Florence Golf Links, which, Mikey, you have a little story here with you and DA of a little golf trip that you guys took to where it was a little bit too cold for good old Mikey Perez, but he still showed up.
Well, I showed up because I had no other option. I mean, it wasn't, hey, can you come do this or do that? It was your flights at this time. I'm going to pick you up from the airport. We're going to go to my house in Bend, and then we're going to drive to Bandon Dunes. And this course was, what, DA, about 30 minutes shy of where we were staying? The first
It's probably night? Like an hour.
Was it?
Yeah.
I was in the back
30
seat.
Minutes, you remember, from after the cocktail was released.
Right,
but,
yeah.
It's a little north of Bandon. Pretty cool spot. Continue. Yeah. I'll let you tell us.
And then we leave Bend and we get up to the top on our way to Sand Pines, and it's snowing. And I'm like, oh my God, it's free. I didn't pack right. There's no way I packed right. So thank God DA had one of his old hand warmers that he used to wear as a quarterback, the Browns. I still have it. So,
I can only imagine.
Yeah, so I still have it, and thank God for that. I mean, and then there's one guy. So we drive there, we play this course, which was amazing, and there's snow in the parking lot. It's raining. It's almost 40 degrees. That's being nice. A little bit of wind, but the fairway was like a river. I'm like, guys, there's no way this course is open. There's how many of us were there? 14, like.
There was 12 of us.
And they're all football players, right? And Muehlenbacher was there, I remember. And this guy's in a golf shirt and shorts. And I couldn't believe it. Golf shirt and shorts on. And I'm freaking.
He went to a rain jacket later on, but he started the day with a golf shirt and golf shorts on. And it literally was snowing all the way over there.
We were there for, what, 7 days or something? At least.
Yeah.
6 to 7 days, and so it's their off season, obviously, and I believe it was in late March or early April is when we went.
Well, that's a tough time to go up to Oregon on the coast, especially.
Yeah, because we went twice. I went twice with the guys, and so we get to Sand Pines. Guys, this course is not open. There's too much water, and secondly, they're not going to let us take a cart, and I'm not carrying my bag.
Oh, boy. Here we go. The bougie golfer, you
should have seen how much booze we had in the damn
big break winner, Disney edition.
In the car, we had so much booze. I mean, what are we going to do? I mean, these guys can carry it, no problem. This little guy, no. So anyway, I go on and talk to the guys in the pro shop. And there's no way you guys are open. Oh, yeah, you can go right now if you want. Yeah, but no carts. He goes, oh, yeah, carts too. I go, what? I mean, you could have taken a boat out there coming down one of these fairways.
The middle of fairway on one was drenched.
It was like a river. But anywho, it did clear up. The course was insane. Great golf course.
I mean, look behind us. This is apparently 18.
That's 18
and then
green.
Number 9. So nine's further up.
Behind you is, so that goes 16 coming down the hill. And then 17's a par 3 going over Mikey's head. That's 18 coming around around the pond.
That's what I thought. Okay, that's what I thought. Boy, that's good.
Look at this. Look at this place. I mean, I'm sorry, podcast listeners. You're just going to have to take a look at the visual on this one.
It's amazing.
This place is fantastic. Look up.
Great place. Honestly, like the reason why we do it is because it's kind of like a little over halfway on the way down. We play that one. There's a casino relatively close, five minutes away. And we normally stay at the casino, play a little cards, play golf, and then
go
across
the street.
Morning.
Go across the street, get the booze.
Yeah, and then drive down the banner.
Yeah.
Let me run you through what Mikey did on that golf course.
Yeah, please do.
Real quick. Let me just give it to you. So it was literally, he had the hand warmer on, he had a mitts on, he had a stocking cap on, he had four jackets, rain pants. We had a cart heaters. We all brought cart heaters. So we all had our own cart heaters because we knew it was going to be
two pairs of socks.
Two pairs of socks. And proceeds to just slap it around this place quite nicely. In soggy fairways, obviously preferred lies when it was in the water. The bunkers were like full of mud or full of water. But
yeah,
he gets it around. He's got her down there. 18 tee coming up there. Pond on the left. Good luck. I think you were 7 under.
Something like that. Going into that hole.
Going into 18. Hits it in the drink on his second shot. Par. Takes a drop. Gets her up and makes par. No. Sorry. I am sorry. No,
I think.
I screwed this up. You were 9 under and you made double bogey on
That's
18.
That's right. On 18.
And you shot 67.
That's correct.
That is the actual story. I forgot.
That's it. Yeah. I double bogey because I had
to
drop
way
up. You
didn't make double. And it was no BS. It was 40 degrees, and I was miserable, but I was, like, not bitching because I'm, like, watching. I'm, like, this is incredible. Like, he's hitting it quite nice. And it was – you didn't even want to be out there.
So only because it was cold. Well, it was cold. Remember, I think I was just getting through my hand.
I think I went to the car.
I was drinking with you. Don't be silly. No. Remember,
I know you were drinking, but I had to continue mine
properly. 100%. Well, the thing was, too, Manny, is – that was right around where my hand was feeling better, if I recall. So the cold, I was a little worried about with the thumb. So that was one of the reasons. But as long as we had a cart, that's all I cared about. If all the boys are going to play, what am I going to do, sit there? I mean, no. So we had a great, great time, except for that double on 18.
I just love that the San Diego boys all wrapped up in like four layers of rain gear.
I was cold.
Got his mitts on. He's got.
Freezing.
He had to ask for your hand warmer from the NFL.
Ask. I saw it in the house and I grabbed it. And I said, "Hey, I'm using this." I'm using this.
I think we stayed at a friend's house that night. Actually, mm-hmm. It was a wonderful cabin.
Cabin.
Slept like no exaggeration. Slept like 30 15? People.
Yeah, 30.
That fireplace was the biggest thing you've ever seen in your life.
Yeah, you made us.
Somebody ended up in the lake that night. I don't remember exactly who or what or how, but
who was in the lake?
Somebody fell off the top bunk. It's a. I'm
not
sure who fell off the top bunk.
You're bringing back memories for Mikey. It just clicked.
Was that the absinthe night?
That was the absinthe night.
Okay. Yeah, I found a bottle of absinthe in the at the liquor store. Yeah, it worked. That's right. I wasn't awake.
Fell out of the bed.
But how big of a fire did you... The fire you made... This fireplace is as tall as him. DA66. Oh. This thing... He had this fire.
Easily 7 feet wide. And it was putting, you know, like normal logs are like.
And it was,
you know,
tall, like, though.
Yeah.
I was putting logs in there.
Longer than that.
They were like, oh, but the average one was like this big. And yeah. I was throwing them in there. And this, all of our stuff was soaked from the day before.
Yes.
So I pull it. I'm like, oh, I'll dry this thing out here real quick. I just started dumping logs on there. And they're like, you're going to break the fireplace. I'm like, it's made out of rocks. I'm like,
break the fireplace.
I couldn't break the fireplace.
Well, I remember cutting up the wood in the back, too.
Oh, that was, yeah, we ran out of
wood.
With
an axe. Me with an axe. Me with an axe. Oh, yeah. I mean, the.
Who put you in charge of cutting wood?
Absinthe?
Yeah, that's true. That would do it. For sure.
That was a great trip. And then, so we did that, and then we went to Bandon. And now it's just
good
as cold.
Old Bandon.
Now, no rain, and now it's time to walk, and it's 36 holes a day, because these guys want to play golf. They want to play 36.
Yeah, what'd you do without a cart there, Mikey?
I was fine. We had caddies. Derek got us caddies. I had Nesty. Nasty Nesty. Remember Nesty? God, it was the greatest. Yeah, we had a great time there, was because we met up with more people when we got there. If I recall, there was another group of guys we met up with that trip.
Yep.
Right.
Yep. So yeah, we normally go like on a, this, it's a big trip. It's 16 guys. And if anybody that's listening that hasn't been to Bandon and you want to go on a great guys trip, it's honestly, it's the best one to do. I mean, I'd Pinehurst is cool, but Bandon's great. You literally go down there and your phone doesn't really work, or it used to not work at all. Phone doesn't work great down there. You're on campus. You don't have to drive anywhere. You play golf all day, go home, drink some more, sit by the fire. I mean, it's a long 4 or 5 days there, but it's worth it if you're trying to get a good crew of dudes together and just play golf.
Yeah, because whatever you had set up, you know, I remember having a dinner one night and all the boys were there. And
so you can do like little mini packages. So
yeah.
Like, if you have 16 dudes or whatever, they'll do like a little dinner for you. You get like a voucher for breakfast, a voucher for dinner, and all that jazz.
It was really great.
They do a great job.
Mikey, we should get a pull hook golf event up there, huh?
You do.
What do you think? Shit.
Well, with DA,
yeah,
I'd like for you to see this course too. You would love this. Then go, but this you would love.
This course behind me reminds me.
I would rather play there every day.
I did
day.
The Ireland trip years back, where we did like 5 different golf courses in Ireland. Old Head being one of them. Doonbeg. We just went along the coast of Ireland, and it was just unbelievable. But same thing. It was freezing out for the majority of the days. Mikey would have been begging for your hand warmers.
Oh yeah, those things are part of the.
I shouldn't say that because I'm the same way. I love warm weather. I hate cold weather. So I'm in the same boat. I'm ripping on you, Mikey.
It's cold. It's okay.
I am the same exact way.
It's not like I haven't played in it before. You know, that's how final stage of Q school was. I remember 3 years, and it was just brutal. I mean, you can't even feel your grips. You can't. But you know, I couldn't drink during those events. You know, but I'm gonna try. Next time I get there, I'm gonna do it. You know.
Hey, PG Tour officials.
Piss on them. I know them all anyway. It doesn't matter. And, you know, there's ways around it, I'm sure.
I'm sure.
We're going to find out.
I mean, but...
if OJ can get away with murder, I'm sure I'll be able to have some kind of...
Allegedly.
Mikey.
Yeah, I hear it. Sorry.
Why even waste your time? Right? Why even waste your time going back to Q school when... I mean, Robert Garrigus just got on to the LIV Invitational Tour.
If I got the call for $10,000,
Greg Norman,
I'd be gone.
PSA, we have done this in multiple episodes. PSA, if you need two guys to hack it around, and maybe just one hack it around where the other one actually has a shot because he's got a new knee and he's playing quite well. And so that's Mikey Perez. I'm on the other side. If you need two pro golfers to come in and just have a blast, then please, God, hit us up, Greg Norman. I watched your 30 for 30. It was fantastic. Yeah. We'll get to that in a second.
Exactly.
But your LIV Invitational Tour, there is a guaranteed total purse of $255 million. And now we're starting to see the dominoes drop. We're seeing Robert Garrigus. Who would have thunk that Robert Garrigus would be the first fucking guy to all of a sudden be on the LIV Invitational Tour?
I don't know. The guy that doesn't need the money the most gets it. I mean,
well, you were telling me he's with Smuckers, right?
His family is Smuckers.
Yeah. The jelly.
Yeah, you know Garrigus.
I saw him the other day.
I love him.
Hit a ball over the mountain at Silverleaf, and I was like,
it's incredible.
I go, tell me what happens after you do that, because he was hitting it like 350.
Yeah, yeah.
That's his problem. He doesn't know what to do after that.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember him. I remember, you know, he was giving kind of like Finau a little jab, and you know, Finau, I love death, and he got jealous. I go, dude, Finau hits it. I got to Garrigus. I go, dude, Finau, that's 30 yards past that. And then he goes, yeah, what tour is he on? I go, oh, okay.
Wow.
So here we are now.
Yeah.
12 years later. Do you think he'd say it now? I mean, Garrigus, I love you. You know that, but.
The other thing, let me point this out, Mikey, and I don't mean to interrupt you, but this is a very important topic.
That's all I need to say.
You, the other day, when I was playing with you at Greyhawk, Mikey Perez was bombing the ball. He was hitting it a good 325 out there. I mean, he's got this little boring ball flight that is just going a mile. I don't know what Fujikura did for him, but my God, is that just like tip stiff and just boring, and then that thing hits and it runs. He's like Colin Morikawa out there. That thing is going 325 past Dustin Johnson. Just an absolutely exploding drive out there. And I got to tell you, it's very impressive. And Greg Norman,
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Listen, Greg. If you're listening, which you're probably not, once again, and it's disappointing.
Well, we'll look forward to Elk, and then we'll see what Elk does. Get to him.
So, anyways, we digress, and we digress often on this show.
Well, I appreciate that, Maddie. Maddie, thank you for that, because, you know, it's been a weird couple months, and, you know, getting used to this new, the way I could push now again off my right side. Dia, you've had plenty of injuries and coming back from them. I mean, it just feels good to feel whole again, right? So, my confidence level and everything else is just going through the roof onto the golf course.
Just had to, Mikey. Sorry. You were talking.
Well, I'm just saying.
I'm all out.
Talking about injuries. But it feels great. You know, I had a little bad luck the other day, but it's all good. So, I mean, injuries suck.
We'll get to the Parker Open. But hang on. DAO, I do want to hear from your perspective. I mean, in free agency, we often see it not only in the NFL, but across sports, to where as soon as one big free agent falls, all of a sudden the dominoes start falling and you start to see more and more guys start to get signed. And Mike, you're hiding behind your mic over there, but you start to see more and more guys start to fall. Do you get the same sense with this whole LIV Invitational Tour that you think like more guys are going to start to fall because more names are starting to come out than we've heard previously, and more rumors of guys are starting to come. And then, well, Garrigus started it, but Phil, I think Phil's the name that all of a sudden everybody's like, okay, cool, Phil's in it. Now all of a sudden we can start to put in our, because they have to actually put in a request
correct.
By the PGA Tour to go play on this.
So he's asking, Phil's asking, I didn't mean to cut you off, but Phil is asking for permission to defend his title at the PGA. So I don't know how that's going to go, but I mean.
Doesn't the whole entire deal. So the reason why they're making them ask for permission is because they can't play one of those events if there's a conflicting PGA Tour event going on at the same time.
Correct.
And I believe you can only do that three times in a season.
And it's a John Deere that week.
Right. So that's where they have to ask for permission, which. I get it. Like, I mean, those guys are getting paid a lot of money on the big tour to, you know,
represent the big tour,
represent them every single week. Now, if guys want to go play three of those events a year and it doesn't conflict with other things on the tour, so be it or whatever. But I don't think you even, I think, well, they just do it in the fall. Like, I don't even know why they're messing with trying to have these tournaments.
I agree.
During the middle of the season, do it when people aren't watching golf, when there's no golf on TV.
I think they're doing it on purpose.
You're going to get some of the golf courses, some of the locations, you're going to have to go to some weird places.
I would for 200.
Greg Norman has been aggressive throughout his entire career. I mean, he's the goddamn shark. I mean, he's right. Going around like this out there.
Who got bit by a great white shark, mind you.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. The guy is a little snake bitten by some of the things that took place. I mean, that was in the 30 for 30 documentary on him, which was absolutely phenomenal. Guys, watch it. It's awesome. He owns it all, which is really cool to see. But you can tell, like, he was the guy who was flying in helicopters to golf tournaments. Mm-hmm. He was the flashy guy that was showing up in Ferraris, and he had the stable of cars before there ever was an Ian Poulter, right? Because we all know Ian Poulter's got a shitload of cars down in Isleworth and so forth. But the whole thing is, like, Greg Norman is that aggressive guy. He's going after it. And I do think that the PGA Tour felt attacked. And I think that that was Greg Norman's approach. He wanted them to feel threatened because he's like, listen, I got all this Saudi money behind me. I'm going to give you guys guaranteed money. If you guys want a good lifestyle and just come on out and start to win a lot of money where you're not going to make this much money on the tour, then come on out for 6 events. Yeah. And, you know, the word is right now, and I want to get everybody's take on this. It's kind of open forum now.
Okay.
Is that I've heard rumblings that DJ is going to do it. I've heard rumblings that Adam Scott is going to do it. Kevin Na. I love it because somebody found out about Kevin Na doing it, and Kevin, with the most like politically correct answer ever, he goes, "I have not put in a request for to skip the tour event to go play." Sure. So that was his. But yeah, clearly Kevin Na would love to go out and play on that tour. But like Dustin Johnson, I mean, Dustin Johnson's living the goddamn dream right now. I mean, he just got married to Paulina. Did you guys see him and how happy he was fishing?
Yeah, he was happier because he missed a cut, right?
Somebody put up a photo of him fishing versus him winning the Masters. And this guy's got the biggest smile on his goddamn face. Dustin Johnson, go play the LIV Invitational Tour, my man. Go win that $255 million. I envy that guy so much. My God, what a legend.
So just to ask you a quick question. So it's $250 million purses.
255 total purses. Yeah, that's guaranteed for the overall, for 6 events. 6 events.
So what does that come out to roughly?
I'm not a mathematician. I just know it's a lot of money, and that's fantastic.
So you're making money regardless. You just show up, you're making money because there's no cut, correct?
That's what I believe.
That's what I've heard, too.
Yeah, I think so.
Right?
You're guaranteed money. So, like, Robert Garrigues is just showing up.
Yeah, I don't blame Garrigues for doing it. No, that's me like neither.
Garrigues, great work.
It's like DA getting picked up. Let's say they paid him 20 grand. 25, I'll give
you. Yeah, should I have thrown you into the PSA? I feel like I jaded you. I apologize. Nah. Greg Norman.
Game sucks right now.
Okay, that's fine.
Go on. You don't need it. Hey, that's... 42, it's like 42 and some change million. For the per event for that deal.
Wow. See, this is a guy who has dealt with NFL contracts.
No, he just went on his phone and looked. He did the math.
I started to do it, and then my brain started to actually work a little bit.
All right, so we'll call 42 going into 12 events. Okay, 12, 14, yeah.
Six.
I thought there were 12 events.
No, there's 6.
Clearly, we can't do math.
No, I thought. No, I can't. But,
no, there's no chance.
Oh, I thought there's six of them. Like,
no, it's 6 events at 255.
And that's it.
There's 6 events. That's it.
So as a
and I think it's 5, and then there's like a tour championship basically type of deal.
I just don't get it, DA, because pro golfers are basically individual contractors, right?
Correct.
I mean, would you compare that to a free agent? While you're playing, how would you compare the two as a golfer compared to a football player? If you're a free agent, but golfers are all independent contractors.
Yeah, I totally agree. I don't think many people have a problem with the fact that the tour is going on. I think it's what goes on in the country that the money originates.
Right.
And ultimately, like, a lot of people don't even realize, but The Saudis have more money in tech companies in this country. They're one of the largest firms in the entire downtown New York. They own things that people have no idea. They're one of the largest shareholders in Twitter, Disney, Uber. I mean, you go down the list and they want to throw a fit about where this money comes from. People are using Uber every single day. People are using Twitter every single day. You know, they're using all these things, Disney. I mean, all these things.
I had no clue.
Oh, no, everything. Saudi, I mean, the Saudi money's everywhere. It's not faux pas. Yeah.
Exactly. And so I think that's the bigger issue. But my thing with it is, it is what it is, right? I mean,
right.
If people knew where the money comes from in anything that they use, they might not do it, you know. But they're trying to make a big deal about it because it's a competition with the PGA Tour, which – I still don't think you compete with the PGA Tour.
Nobody
the best
can.
Players in the world.
No.
The best players in the world aren't going to give up the chance to play for $42.5 million a week.
Being the top 125.
But it's also legacy. It's like what Brady's doing right now.
It's who. How many championships did you win? How many majors did you win?
Exactly.
Right. Not how much money you made. Now, if you're just in it to make the money, you don't care about winning the Masters. You don't care about winning a major, period. Go do it. Well, go do it. Yeah. Go be the best guy out there.
Now, but,
I mean, it's just, I don't know. I mean, I don't think if they're going to, you know, restrict guys from playing majors and doing all that other jazz, that doesn't make any sense to me at all.
I just don't think the PGA Tour has ever been threatened with anything like this where, like, they were terrified. They were absolutely terrified, and they overreacted to the situation, and then they made an example out of Phil, and then they just – it was kind of this tumbling effect, and now it's like, okay, seven-day media cycle, let's let that run, and it's all been calm. You didn't hear a damn thing about Phil Mickelson during the Masters. Not a damn thing.
No.
There was not one word about him. Exactly. And so that was part of the whole calming of the media. Let's stop talking about Phil. Let's calm this whole thing down, and then let's deal with it when the time comes to where these guys are going to start requesting these approvals. And that's where we are now, to where now that tumble effect, that domino effect is going to start taking place. And I think Adam Scott's the next one. I think he's the next one that puts in that request, because Adam Scott, Jesus Christ.
He's so good. But, you know, at his age, not to go off subject here, but for Phil Mickelson to ask permission to go defend his title is bullshit. He won the PGA, and if he wants to go defend his title, he should.
Well, it goes back to one of our earlier episodes. He's suspended right now. He's got to ask for permission to go defend.
Do we know what is he suspended for? Do we even know?
Yes, we do. Because he's the one that was getting a bunch of guys into it. I mean, here's a list. So here, let me talk about the list real quick. So we've got Garrigus, who already put in his request. Phil is the next one to fall. Just happened today. Dustin Johnson is rumored, Kevin Na is rumored, Bryson DeChambeau is rumored, and Adam Scott is rumored. Those are the big names so far.
Requested? So, when you say requested, they're requesting to the tour, or?
They put in their request. So only Phil and Garrigus so far have put in their request. The rumblings around it is all from off-the-record conversations with these guys. Okay. And, of course, as soon as they're asked about it, like Kevin Na had the perfect response. I have not put in an application yet.
Okay. So blah, I just blah. Don't like, know.
Yeah,
I mean,
of course.
I don't know what's going on yet. That's why I rely on my partner, Matt. So here's to Matt. And I was at somewhere with no service for 5 days. So I didn't get caught.
Mikey was in the perfect spot. He was at a river by a bar playing in a pro golf tournament. Doesn't get much better than that.
Staying in a fifth wheel. No TV, no phone working, and it was wonderful. So
that was my Instagram
question. Sounds like a little West Texas driving range action.
But it was amazing.
It was straight tin cup. When Mikey sent me the videos, he's like, hey, post these on Instagram on our story. And it's like a walkthrough. I felt like I was watching John Daly back in the day, like walking through his fifth wheeler, like, hey, this is my crib for the week. Here you go. Take a look. I've got a big screen TV that's 28 inches big. And I got a refrigerator, which, by the way, Mikey points out in the video that the most important aspect of the fifth wheeler was a working refrigerator.
And it didn't work, or it did?
No, it did. Oh, and he pointed it out. I mean, he made sure that everybody knew this was the most important aspect to his entire stay there.
And the AC.
Who's fifth wheel are you in? Whose fifth wheel are you in?
My buddy who owns this, my buddy Donnie. He's the one that has set me up there.
Yeah, he owns that bar down on the river too, right, Mikey?
Foxes.
So the guy owns the bar. He set up Mikey in his fifth wheeler. Mikey had the absolute, just like he was in heaven out there. I was afraid he was never coming back. That's why when I opened up this episode, I'm like, man, we've been through 5 episodes. We're on episode 6. Are you fucking kidding me? Like, we've made it this far? Mikey's still in this?
Yeah, we tried to do the show because I brought all my gear for the show, like my green screen and everything. And I couldn't get Wi-Fi. I couldn't get anything. My cell phone barely worked. It was actually, besides not being able to do the show, I could live without everything else. It was wonderful.
I'm with you, brother. There's times when I'm thinking about selling the farm and just buying a piece of land in
Montana.
Put a 4-bedroom flat piece of property, just put a barely roof over it and build a barn.
I mean, it was great. Exactly. And just to see everybody out there so mellow, so cool. Everybody in Parker treated us so great. It was just nice. It was a nice change. And I kind of needed that.
And you made the cut.
I made the cut, yeah.
Even with some knee issues. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about that, Mikey.
Damn it. It was on my 27th hole. I just lipped out 6 putts for birdie prior to that. That was my front 9. It was my front 9, but I teed off at 10. 18 is kind of a dog leg right. And I hit it on top of the hill. And I just wanted to get back out into play. Well,
I love that the words are coming out, but your lips aren't moving.
What's that?
I think you're frozen, my friend. It's okay. Keep going. No, you're back. You're back. We just had a momentary technology freeze on your side. You're all good. Are you frozen or not? Like, are you messing with us now? Oh, I think we've completely lost Mikey at this point. I think... DA, have you ever seen those shirts by like Travis Matthews, or they do the hats too, like I don't give a fuck about your score?
Right.
Yeah, we just completely lost Mikey.
The G4.
Yes. No one
cares.
Yeah. I felt that. Like we were getting to that moment with Mikey where I'm like, dude, I don't want to hear about your shot for shot. I just don't want to do it.
Yeah, he'll be all right. He just gets a little excited about and scrapping around. First off, I have no idea where Parker's at. I need to get a little info.
I don't either. When he told me about that, and I'm out here in Arizona, and I'm in Scottsdale, and I'm like, hang on a second, where is Parker? And he's like, man, it's out by this river. He's like, don't worry about it. We're going to do the show. I've got Wi-Fi. He gets out there, and he finds out that the Wi-Fi is like 15 kilobytes per second, which isn't even like dial-up at this point. So he's straight back into the 80s, and he couldn't get on. So that's why we had to delay the show from last week to this week, and it's just like, holy cow. I started to lose it. I'm like, this is the funniest shit ever. He's in a fifth wheeler out there. He can barely get text through to me. So he's like trying to send me stuff. He's trying videos. There's nothing. It was coming through like 10 hours later. And he's like, holy cow, I'm so glad that finally came through. But we definitely lost Mikey. He lost internet connection somewhere along the lines. But DA, you've been an absolute blast, my man. Thank you for coming on. Thank you for sharing some of the stories about the NFL and so forth. But the last question that I do have for you is, do you have anything coming up golf-wise? Like, are you going to be playing? You've played in a lot of celebrity tour events. Are you planning on playing in any more?
I got a big invitational deal at Whisper Rock in a couple weeks. It's a pretty competitive deal. I get kind of a big crew of the kind of the top amateur golfers across the country. But it's a best ball deal.
So you're going to be training a little bit, huh?
I'm trying to. I played this weekend. We had a member guest, actually, that played pretty good. So we'll see what happens. But I'm supposed to play a deal down in San Diego at the Sequan Casino Resort down there at the end of May. So we'll see how. I'm not 100% sure I'm going to be able to make it work, but trying to work things with the kids' schedules and all that, just because it's right at the end of school and you know, you have dance performances and all that jazz. So
yep, you got all those responsibilities.
Yeah, I mean, it's good though. You know, if I can play a couple, you know, it's just fun to go compete. You know, it's that's the biggest thing for me. Like I play with a lot of the tour guys at Wish Rock and kind of around town. I really enjoy it, but I get my butt whipped quite a bit.
All right,
but to go play with guys are kind of
look
more,
who popped back in
for my speed. What are you doing?
What happened?
He ripped his vape as he's coming back.
No, what happened?
After he lost, you lost internet connection, my friend.
I did?
Yeah.
CenturyLink.
Yeah.
CenturyLink.
I mean, are you still having hangovers from Parker?
No.
No, so DA was just cluing us into some of the stuff that he's got coming up to get ready for the celebrity tour. And I'm actually thinking, as I'm hearing this from DA,
he's good.
I think we should go out and play around. Yeah. I mean, we're all here in Scottsdale,
he's
right? Yeah, you're here in Scottsdale.
Yep, yeah,
I think we should go out and shoot a little content for not only Pull Hook Golf Podcast, but have a little money match because, goddamn, for the first time, I picked up clubs and I had two torn hamstrings. I was reminiscing.
Buddy,
by the way, as you were telling me, you're like, man, I knew I was getting old. I got hit real hard. My back got all messed up. And I'm sitting there going, I pulled two hamstrings in my very first slow pitch softball game.
They were bruised.
No.
Shit.
Oh, there were bruises all day.
Yeah.
I literally pulled both hamstrings in a slow pitch softball game, which I haven't played slow pitch softball in like 5+ years. I decided to go do it since I'm back here in Arizona. And I'm like, this is the thing to do. I want to be competitive. I've played baseball growing up throughout. And as soon as like a ball was hit, like in the gap, all of a sudden I lose complete like consciousness as far as like I am now no longer in shape. I should not like have fast twitch like muscles, and immediately I go for it and I pop one. Then all of a sudden I'm pitching in the next inning because I'm like, I can't move. I've popped one hamstring and there's like a dribbler in between me and the first baseman, and I go to reach down for it and I pop the other one. I go, oh, son of a bitch.
That's
like, I've
got
to hit a gym. I've got to get into a gym.
No, just stretch.
And then I saw like a clip of us recently to where we were at a Greyhawk and I go, wow, I'm fat as shit. I was like, I don't look like that on Zoom calls, which is great.
Hey,
but at the same time, I'm like, man, I need to lose some damn weight. So we should all go out and play some golf. But the first round that I actually picked up clubs in probably like since September, I go out with Mikey, and Mikey just abuses me out there. Well, I started it. I ripped on Mikey.
You're a New Yorker.
Like Mikey had a little flub and he didn't like that I filmed it.
Oh,
and he got a little mad at me about it.
Back
so
left pin
from then on, I was destroyed for the rest of the golf round because I was laying sod over shots. Like, Mikey's sitting there
he
going,
put up all my
thank
bad
God you're
shots.
Doing media.
He put up all my bad shots.
I put up all mine, too.
No,
I put all of mine were up there.
I sent them to you.
I'll hit some bad shots. I'll hit some bad shots you guys can laugh at.
The par three.
Appreciate it.
Dan on Raptor. What is it? Four or five? Five. Pin was back left. I'm pin high left.
No, you're wrong.
Hitting towards Savvy's
house.
House.
No,
that's what I said.
Three.
Par three. It's actually par five.
You're right.
Yeah.
It was.
It was like hitting towards Savvy's old house.
Oh, that one. Yeah.
Yeah. So the pin's back left. I just carry the bunker, and I got the Bermuda going into me. I know if I don't hit it where I need to, it's gone. If I hit it short, the result is what happened. And then, of course, he's filming, and proceed to make double.
You literally laid sod over the chip.
No.
He
go,
flubbed
you want
it.
To see laid sod.
He went right underneath it. And of course I'm filming
trying to get,
it.
Trying to get
of
cute.
Of course I'm filming it. He got cute with it, tried to make the perfect shot because he's on camera. And I felt bad. And like I wasn't gonna post
Don't
it originally.
Ever feel bad. Don't
but,
ever feel bad.
But his reaction to it was what actually made me post it because he started giving me the finger. He started getting really upset about it. And I'm like, really? Like if you're gonna get upset about it, I might as well just post it. Because I haven't posted it yet.
Yes.
Yeah. Why not?
That's
and
what
of
we're
course
doing.
His follow-up chip went like 30 feet back.
It caught the damn lip, too, and it hit the lip, and it goes even farther. I go,
and I'm sitting there
this.
With the commentary going,
X.
Yeah, that wasn't much better.
X.
And so, poor X. Mikey. But then from there, I was destroyed because I did not have my game in the least. At least I went out. Mikey was supposed to come out with me and my brother-in-law for another round. He couldn't make it because his knee was all sore and everything. And it was. So for me, yeah, it was. No, I'll give you that.
It was.
Because Mikey had a few, like, he was struggling towards the end of that round. And so 2 days later, we had another round scheduled. Me and my brother-in-law go out. And then, of course, I go out and shoot one over because I've actually picked up a golf club. I've actually shot and actually hit golf shots. I'm not chasing you,
old
man.
You're trying to catch up with the old man.
DA, here's what you can expect.
It's like having a
catch. If you do go out and play golf with us here, you're not only are you going to get prepared for anything competitive you have coming up, but you are going to hear this all day long, which I don't know if that's a good thing or bad thing.
Okay, so I'll come back on. If I beat you, I get to come back on and run my mouth for a half hour.
You could run your mouth for an hour.
Done.
Okay, for an hour? Done. Anything I want for
You can
an
do
hour?
Whatever you want
Done.
For an
Anything
hour.
You want. This would be your platform
no,
for an
30
hour.
Minutes is
no,
fair,
45.
He can go
yeah.
through a lot. He can go through a lot.
I think okay, 30 would be good.
I've seen weird shit happen. I don't know. That might get weird.
Well, I remember, I remember the Marlin one year. Thank God you were in town because, of course,
sorry
you
about that eagle on 18. That's my bad.
Of course, I wish you were at the playoffs that year, but I forgot what team you were with then. I think you were with.
I think it was Carolina.
No, really?
Was it the Browns? I don't know. It
definitely wasn't the Browns. I thought it was, pink shirt moment.
It might have been.
I think it was here, but either way. But
probably
I was
not.
Just glad you're in town because my partner canceled the.
That's not a good partner right there.
Well, he is a great partner. I just, I'll leave the name out of it, but he wasn't able to play.
He had a bad back.
Yeah, his back was killing him and his shoulder. And yeah, he fell. That's the problem, his shoulder.
I mean,
it was his shoulder and his back.
You don't even know who it was, but he's not 25 years old.
No, he's not. But he's a great guy, and thank God DA was there. I'm like, DA, let's go. I got the golf cart ready. Did I have
we
the
had
I...
a blast. We had a car on the golf course.
Car.
A cart. We had a car.
And I'll send the video of that. Well, Matt, I've shown you my cart. Yeah.
I've seen the cart. The cart. The fire orange cart. And
yes,
then it got wrapped. And then it's like, yeah, we're trying to bring it back to life. We're going to figure out a way to do this and put Bull Hook Golf on the side of it.
Didn't I take that thing through the drive-thru at Starbucks? I think I took
it
through the drive-thru.
Yeah, we drove it.
It's street legal. It's street legal.
Well, the license plate says no IQ.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a Scion IQ.
Damn thing.
Yeah, that's the best part. When him and Mulder were in it, because Mulder has the Hummer golf cart. So him and Pat use that. So I'm like,
oh boy.
My partner and I are like, we got to come up with something better. So we had a full year to plan this. So we took a Scion IQ, cut the top off, took out a lot of weight, and then I got Del
I'll post
Cochran
this.
Say,
I'll post this down.
And I got
you,
Del
you've
Cochran
sent me these,
say,
and I've held on to them.
Yeah,
I'll post it
there's
on our
white,
social
there's
media
one in
page.
White. There's one that we wrapped it white, and then the original lava color, it's called orange. And then Pat drove it to the tournament, to the waste management, where it said Pat Perez, then Mike's brother underneath it. Remember in quotes, DA?
Yeah.
John Felix, thank you for that.
DA.
The car
DA,
is amazing.
It's fantastic.
It
I got,
and DA,
12s.
Thank you so much for taking the time out to come on the show. And if you do beat us, or me or Mike, then 30 minutes. I
30
think
minutes
that's
of just
what it is.
All
yeah, platform.
On the show
this platform is
minutes.
You. Yep, you're gold.
Matty,
you're
the gold. Thing is, the thing is on the course. It's still going to be the same. It doesn't matter if it's on the course or it's at a bar or at a restaurant or in his car. It's always something. You're going to hear bantering like you've never heard it. But there is something that I have to say because to this day. I'm
oh,
surprised
boy.
His head isn't broken or his neck from when he, from what it sounded like, someone was absolutely just beating the shit out of a toilet at about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Oh.
Okay. And.
Oh no, we're going.
He thought I was asleep. And I go, this is my perfect chance to get him. So it's pitch black. He's up. He's still smashed. We're staying in the cottages at Bend, and I grab his leg, and I don't say anything. And then he did this, holy fuck. Remember how bad I scared you?
The living piss out of me. Because I was just wandering through the room, and somebody grabs my leg in the pitch black.
I mean,
at least I know what to expect on these golf trips. Oh my God,
it was so funny. You bitch! He was so mad and so happy at the same time, and we couldn't stop laughing for 10 minutes. And
then, oh my God.
I'm like, I have to get him. This is too perfect. He just woke me up with the sound of a bowl. Like, just, I mean, this echo.
I'm a dinosaur. Just let me be.
It's incredible. I didn't think that was possible. I mean, it's like turning a horn on inside of a toilet bowl. That's what woke me up.
I'm a dinosaur. I don't know what to
say. I had to get him. That scare, though, was one of the greatest.
Oh, all time.
All time. Mikey, but you got me good. All right, brother. Love you, bro.
Thank you so much.
We'll be in touch. Thank you, brother. Respect. Tell Mal and the family. Give him my best, please.
I will, brother. You guys be good. Let's get it to that tea time schedule.
Just let me know what time.
You skittered.
I'm very busy.
Mikey's raring to go.
I'm really busy.
See you, love you, DA. Thank you.
Later, brother.
Mikey, that was phenomenal. Loved having DA on. My God, that was fantastic.
He's a great guy.
You threw in the toilet incident right at the very end. You had to.
Well, the scare was the best. It was so funny. But no, DA's been a good friend for a long time. I know he's been busy for the last... You know, we've got three kids now and all that. So, and they're growing, His wife is wonderful. His family's wonderful. Very, very, very lucky to have a friend like him, and fortunate. You know, he's one of the good guys, you know, and real, the real guy.
For sure.
So that's
definitely. I've only heard good things about him. I mean, here in the Scottsdale area. And Mikey, I do want to go back real quick since you and I have a little bit more time just to discuss that the LIV Invitational Tour.
Yes.
What do you think's still going on used there? To it.
Well, I'm still, like, that's why I was asking you a couple questions, because I'm not too sure what's going on, or like, I'm trying to catch up today on it, and they're talking about it, and that's why I asked you about the permission.
It went down a little bit, like, the news-wise, and then all of a sudden it picked back up. As soon as Garrigus was the first domino to fall, Phil followed suit not that long after, and that's why I'm like, is this like a NFL, MLB type of scenario all of a sudden like, you always see it in major sports like baseball or basketball or football, to where all of a sudden, like, one big free agent goes, and then all of a sudden everybody starts to sign with teams.
Sure.
And I feel like it's the same thing that we're going to see with this, where this is kind of fun. As a golf person, we've never had, like, free agency.
No.
We've never had, like, this type of talk before. And I think it's added something to the game, to be quite honest. Like, I don't think that this is deterred away from the PGA Tour at all. I think the way that they handled it initially was poor. I don't know if it was the greatest way of handling it. I don't know if they knew how to handle it, right? Jay's never been in that situation before. Jay Monahan.
I don't think any of them have.
No, nobody has from the PGA Tour. So, like, it would have been great if they had, like, seeked advice from, like, the NBA or from MLB or from the NFL. It would have been great to, like, hey, you know, because the NFL's dealt with leagues coming in all the time. The American Football League, the XFL, and they never like, even, like, said a word about any of those previously, you know. And they didn't even, like, blink an eye at it, because they're like, listen, we're the shield. We're the shield of the NFL. Like, there is no other league. We are the NFL. And I felt like the PGA Tour should have taken that same stance.
I agree.
I feel like they got, for the first time ever, like, a little threatened by Greg Norman and what he was doing and having all that money behind him and everything.
Norman's smart,
and
too.
Maybe a little bit. He's a good businessman. Very good businessman.
Him, Elkington, all those old school.
Elk was on the 30 for 30. You got to watch it.
Oh, he was?
Elk was great. Oh, my God. Mikey, you got to get Elk on the show.
We're trying to have
him. You got to get him on on the show.
Well, I'm trying like hell. Because
that was fantastic.
Remember that text like, message I sent
you? Alk had about three different like little tiny like parts in it. Like you can tell. They interviewed him for probably a half hour, maybe an hour, yeah. And they took like three clips that they're like, this is the best of what we got.
Alk's
and
the best.
Man, his one-liners and his little pieces were just phenomenal. And I'm just going, I'm sitting there watching it going, man, if we can get him on the show, I'd love to have Elkington on because he's got some stuff to say.
Well, he's got that, and then he's got his deal, Secret in the Dirt. You know, the guy has so much knowledge in golf. It's crazy. And I just saw him swinging the other day.
I did too on Instagram.
Yeah. I mean,
guy looks great.
I'm sorry, but that's still.
So did Greg Norman, by the way. Yeah. Greg Norman, he's on there. They took him back to Augusta National, and they actually filmed him playing Augusta National. And then he got Nick Faldo on the other side of the freaking documentary, who was his rival throughout the entire thing.
Oh, yeah.
And Nick Faldo did not hold back when he goes, yeah, if I was him, I would never go back to Augusta National.
See, that's what I love, the honesty. That's the way it should be, not this.
That's why I loved it so
around.
Much.
Don't
yeah.
pussyfoot around the damn
dude, subject. Faldo took his shots. Like, Faldo was very PC about it all. Like, if you don't pay attention closely, because he's the robot, he's the mechanic,
true.
He's
true.
The guy who did everything right. He said everything right, he did everything right, and he was always just precise with everything he did, which is why he won the Masters multiple times. But that
true.
Being said, him and Norman, you can tell, there is that rivalry there. And if you read between the lines to what Faldo was saying, it's like, wow. All
I've
of a sudden,
heard.
It opens up the light to be like, Faldo was talking some shit.
Well, I'm not going to give it away yet, but our guest next episode is going to give us a lot of in-depth in as far as what goes on inside the ropes. Yeah,
I'm excited 20, for
25.
I'm excited
plus
for next
years.
Week's show too.
25
I mean,
plus year. But going back to your statement with all of them, you're right. I mean, these old school guys, they get it. You know, they're gonna tell you what's on your mind. They're gonna say it's no PC. It's no pussyfooting around. Maybe Faldo has to because of NBC.
No, but
like
if you read between
the money,
lines with Faldo,
oh yeah, he's a huge Faldo's a huge Iron Maiden fan. Plays drums, so. Nico McBrain from Maiden always sets him up to play a lot of golf down floor. Anyway, I've loved Faldo and the way he swings, the way he swung growing up. Him, Elkington, I mean, Seve, Jose Maria Thobel. And those are swings that are so amazing, I think.
But do you think because Greg Norman was such a great businessman that the PGA Tour just got so scared?
I would be afraid of Greg Norman. If I was a tour, absolutely. And with the Saudi money behind him.
But
and
the
don't think he doesn't have his own money in there. You know he's got his money in there.
Modern day,
he's got his money in.
Well, we've never seen it. So I guess it's hard for me to sit here as a sports fan and go, if the Major League Baseball was attacked, or NBA was attacked, or the NFL was attacked by another league, like that. That's how I took it. I'm like, listen, all the legacy and everything that you want as an athlete is on the PGA Tour. It's all
true.
The majors. It's all. It. I mean, yes, they introduced the FedEx Cup recently. Believe
they should
in
let
that.
The players play. If it's only six events, I thought it was 12 events.
No, it's
so
six.
Forgive me on that. I thought it was 12.
And
so
it starts
if
in
it's
June.
Six events, big deal. Big deal. Let them go play. They're independent contractors. He can't make up this rule just now saying if anybody plays.
Well, you
no.
remember everything that came out of RIV. Nobody's talking about that.
No.
As to the players meeting that Jay Monahan had with everybody that was in the field at the Genesis Open.
Right.
At the RIV. He was sitting there telling them, and the word that we received back is that he was telling them, you cannot go play on this tournament
you
or
can't
else
tell
you
them
will
to
not
do.
Be on the PGA Tour.
I don't agree with that at
I
all.
I don't either.
And here's another thing that's bothering me. That Phil is getting as much crap as he is. And they're saying it's going to ruin his legacy. Now, he chose some bad words.
Poor words. Yeah, absolutely.
But his legacy.
But that's not it.
His legacy? Really? The guy has won over 50, 60 times, whatever it is.
Well, and what's hilarious is that he said these poor words, yet he's going to be able to go play on this tournament.
Correct.
Or because, this tour. This series.
Because they want him.
Yeah, well, that's the entire thing. Nobody else was offended by it.
That's a big middle finger to the tour, unfortunately.
Well, the tour took it as, that was a big middle finger, and that was a, hey, I'm going to go where the money is.
Don't tell me what,
And I just think it's a pissing match at this point. It's like, let me pull out mine and you pull out yours and let's see whose is bigger. And now, it's like, that's not what should be happening right now.
Well, now next year they're going to have to come out because you can't, okay, if that's going to be a rule, that has to be in the player's handbook starting the new season, which would be what, October? Because the first event's, let's just say around Vegas time, right?
Yeah.
That's usually when the new schedule starts. So, I wish they'd just go back to tournament champions, first tournament, then Sony, and then go. But that's just me. Because remember, they only had the 1 or 1.5 month off, 2 months off. That was their downtime, then to get back. But anyway, for them to say that's ruining Phil's legacy is bullshit. Phil has done so much for the game of golf. He's done so much. I mean, it's not just Tiger. It's Phil, too. You know? And there's a good battle between those two, right? It's
like North Carolina and
Duke, right?
Yes, correct.
You know what I mean?
No, you're spot on. It's the rivalry, right? It's Yankees-Red Sox. It's North Carolina versus Duke. Dodgers,
Chargers. Raiders.
Whatever. I don't know if there's that many great West Coast rivalries. I got to be honest.
There are because they're underpaid because they don't want to pay the taxes.
There's a lot of East Coast rivalries.
I'll tell you that.
There's not that many West Coast rivalries. Except Dodgers Giants will probably be a rivalry that you can say is in
like
the
a real rivalry.
Okay. Yeah, that's a real rivalry.
Yeah,
like,
I don't really
Dodgers Giants for baseball. Like, I mean, yeah, people get beat up at
the
those
Doyers?
Games because of it. But
it's
no,
so
what,
stupid because they're fans. Just sit there and watch the game. What are you fighting for? Well, we should.
Well,
have done this.
You get
we
very amped
have done
up.
That.
You
we,
get amped
we,
up.
We.
As
You're
a
not
fan,
on the field.
No, because but as a fan, you buy into the whole entire thing,
East Coast fans.
You're personally attached to it. You're emotionally attached to it. That's the way that fans are. Even West Coast fans, Mikey. That's not just Northeast fans.
No,
I mean,
I know.
Yes,
I know.
A while back, a couple years back, a woman ran over another fan because in a Yankees. Red Sox ordeal and ran over the guy because with her car because
game.
Of the game.
That's
now,
stupid.
Here's the thing.
That's just idiocracy to me.
Well, it's sports, and sometimes we take it way too serious. But at the same time, it's still a game, right?
Well, okay. If I'm watching Iron Maiden or Metallica play, I say, "Well, yeah, we didn't play this set list. We didn't play this song." What do you mean, we? I'm a fan. You get it? It's the same thing. If I'm going to watch my my team.
I got you, Mike.
You see what I'm saying?
I didn't say,
well, we didn't play this song. We didn't play that song. What do you mean, we? Are you in the band? Are you in the crew? Are you driving the truck? See what I'm saying? So fans, stick to what you know, and that's being a fan. None of your coaches. That's it. Stick to being a fan. Don't cause fights. There's kids around.
While this LIV Invitational Tour.
You digress.
No, we head back right to that LIV.
I like it.
To your point, it is just a game.
Correct.
And there should not be that rivalry between the PGA Tour and the LIV Invitational Series.
No, there shouldn't.
There shouldn't be. I mean, if
not with six events.
I told you, and I think it was episode 2, I'm like, I look at this as an entertainment series to where it's like, you've got great names, big names that have played and won majors and won PGA Tour events. Robert Garriga still confuses me a little bit on it.
Did they call him or did he contact somebody else?
None of that's out yet.
That's what I'm curious to know.
I am too.
Like Garrigus, I'm sure he pushed hard for it. I bet you he pushed for it.
Mikey, I want you to text him because I want to find out. I want to see.
Right now.
Yeah, I want to see what that was. If they reached out to him, if it was him just putting it in, hoping that he gets a deal on the LIV Golf Invitational Tour. Like, maybe he was like, listen, I'll be the first one.
Maybe
and
he'll
cut a deal with them.
Tell us
I don't know.
Works.
But at the end of the day, this tour, it's intriguing and it's exciting. But so was the XFL when they were like Vince McMahon, when he came out with the XFL, it was like the most exciting thing ever.
Vince
the NFL did not sweat it at all. At all. Like, they're like, this is great. Like, let people go out there and kill themselves and, like, have all, like, we can learn from this group. That's the same thing that I think the PGA Tour should have taken a step back and gone, we can learn something here. If all of a sudden this is a hit, we don't have to overreact.
No.
Like, we can be reactive here. Like, this is one of those moments to where in business you can be reactive because you already have the legacy. It will take years and years for them to get a legacy started and to start bringing it in. But I think because of how many tour pros and big names were interested, I think they got terrified.
I wonder how they get in it, though. Because I know if they called my brother, Pat would be there in a heartbeat. I know it. And, you know, I know we don't talk about much about that stuff, but I want to know. I texted Garrigus, like you asked, and we'll see if he texts me back.
I want to find out.
I want to know how and who gets picked. Now, do we know how many players are going to be playing in each event? I haven't dug into it that deep.
There are 48 players.
48 players.
Oh, here's the other thing. So the plan right now, according to Sports Illustrated, is that 48 players are going to make up 12 teams. Mikey, we can play on the same fucking team.
Team thing.
We can play on the same fucking team.
Is that Alan Shipnuck's deal? Is that his Alan Shipnuck write that from Sports Illustrated?
Let me double check.
Probably. He's been all over this. I did an interview with that guy a few times and didn't use one word of my thing, but whatever.
It is Bob Herrick. No.
Bob Herrick, okay.
Which Bob Herrick is a legend.
Yeah, he is. So that is interesting because
Mikey, so we could be the Pull Hook Golf Team.
Hey,
Greg Norman. This PSA,
jinx.
Yeah,
you know, every time we do it, it's jinx. Norman drinks.
But Greg, honestly, like now that it's a team event, Mikey and I can ham and egg this fucking thing.
We could. It'll take you a week and a half to just get going when you're not editing our stuff and making us look good.
That's it. I got to lose some weight. But if I know now,
of course, get on high tea.
Well, if I go out now and I start to train, I'll be in shape by June. I think it starts in June.
I lost 6 pounds in those 5 days I was gone, and I ate very well.
Well, as soon as you start walking,
I know. Yeah. I had to keep my knee loose. And then I tried icing it in the middle of it, and it only stiffened it up.
Oh, you know
that
what?
That was a bad idea.
This is great. So this is, and I got to give Jay Monahan credit here.
Okay.
So Jay Monahan already said that, technically this was back at the Players' Championship, so I think he was being a little facetious here because obviously, wasn't RIV after the Players' Championship?
I think No.
Is it before?
RIV is always before. Yeah, RIV is like the top
so
first
by,
six.
So by the time the Players' Championship came
it's
about,
West Coast Swing. Remember
he
that.
Said that, as we have stated repeatedly in recent weeks, the PGA Tour has moved on. When asked about what they thought about the
just
now? Invitational
Series. They said that this week.
No, they said it right as... So Bob Herrick, as he came out with this article on Sports Illustrated, and this article's actually really good. They asked Jay Monahan, and he said this at the Players' Championship.
Okay.
So, and he said...
We're
speaking, and yeah. He's basically saying that, like, we've moved on. So when they asked him for comment recently on this, he goes, as we've stated previously at the Players' Championship, we've moved on from this. So clearly they're starting to take the cue as to we're not in trouble. this is just going to be a standalone tour. And here's like what they're gonna everything need to... that took place, and it's fine.
Yeah. Here's what they need to do. This is what the tour guys deserve, and this is what they will probably want. Now, if NCAA, now hear me out here. If NCAA kids get money now, why doesn't a PGA Tour player, no matter how long you've been on tour, maybe they could figure out a way to prorate the differences. If you're a 20-year veteran, why shouldn't they get $250,000 to $500,000?
It's just like prior everything.
Because of all the goddamn money they're making on the pod on their broadcast,
Mikey.
It's the exact
same thing that everybody goes through.
But it's these guys are getting paid. The golfers aren't. But here's the thing:
when you budget for money, you have expectations of what you've done previously. So the PGA has been raking in that revenue, right?
Sure.
So they're expecting that revenue to carry over to the following year. So they're not all of a sudden going to say, hey, let's cut $200 million from our revenue and give that to the players.
Golf Channel is got so much money.
You don't give that until somebody forces you into that situation to where you're forced to have to give that money up.
I hope the players go on strike. I hope all you PGA Tour players out there go on strike, take your money from your companies, go on strike, and demand the money for what you deserve. For what you deserve. Especially the guys that have missed 10 cuts in a row, that worked their asses off for the previous years on the Corn Ferry Tour. They deserve that. You know, you need a little crutch to get going. It gives you confidence when you have money in the bank. You know, when you're playing with zero in the bank, not saying that some of these, you know, they get paid fine, but all the contracts, you know, have gone down a lot. And we could thank the Monday qualifiers for product and all that stuff and whatever they do with their crap, you know. So
we talked about that on the last episode. Yeah,
exactly. It's bullshit, you know, and it, just for the Daryl survey to get a count up, I'm going to take, you know what I mean? It's ridiculous, but I think they deserve some part of that money. Give them $250. Give them $300.
Let's clarify something. The Monday qualifier situation came up when the manufacturer started to struggle, and TaylorMade almost got sold to Nike.
A long time ago when I was out there.
That started to lead to the manufacturer struggling, which was that the cause of it? Most likely not. It was just the fact that, yeah, they were marketing the same stuff over and over again. I get it.
Every rep I talk to.
Yeah, I know. There's bitterness because they're like, listen, this was the way we used to do it. It used to make a lot of sense. And then this happened. And then, you know, manufacturers like us, we started to struggle a little bit. And they went through that lull to where, when the economy goes down, people don't buy as many golf clubs. And like, there's that whole vicious cycle where the economy leads to a lot of this stuff. But at the end of the day, when we look at this LIV Invitational Tour and what it's doing, I think it's doing a good thing to where I do too. Greg Norman, man, I'm telling you what. I mean, Mikey, how many final round of Q schools did you make it to?
Six.
Mikey Perez made it to six.
I never got to La Quinta, though.
Final stages of Q school.
I never got to La Quinta. I never got to where
six stages.
Knew.
Here's the thing.
That was one of the six rounds.
Greg Norman,
too.
You got a feel for us, man. How many Masters did you play in, and how many did you have that challenge in to where you never ended up pulling through? And guess what? This is Mikey Perez's shot.
Yeah.
Let me join him on this.
You are. I won't do anything without you.
Listen, it's a team event. I mean, we can go out there.
Ham and egg it.
We'll ham and egg the whole
green
thing.
Green eggs and ham. Not
green
ham
eggs and ham.
Green eggs and ham. I'm in.
I got to tell you, anybody who wants a match against me and Mikey, good luck.
Yeah, that's true. Give us a couple. Just give my partner here a little week here
let me stretch out the hammies. Yeah, let me get him in good shape.
You still have the game. You're fine.
We'll get there.
You're fine. We'll both get there. We're both working on this together.
I know.
I'm still not there. I'm 75%.
I know. We're
I was up, but then I went back down.
We were a
but
little
I'm okay now.
we're a little packed up with stuff today because we didn't do the show on our normal recording day because Mikey was out playing in his golf tournament. And so
can I say something about that real quick?
Yeah, go for
it. I would like to thank everybody at Emerald Golf Course and the Parker Open for their hospitality, the volunteers, everybody that put in all the work so we could enjoy ourselves with our team. They do a wonderful job. I haven't played it in 7 years. And it's funny because when I started playing again back then, as Parker Open was the opener. Now, I didn't play as well. It was blowing 30 miles an hour. Same as this, you know. But the place and volunteers and the staff, the course, thank you for everything. I don't know how many players do that anymore, but I still write emails to the court tournament director and the head pro thanking. That's what I do. I learned from my buddy Mark Damascal years ago about that. It's the right thing to do. So to the Parker Open and their staff and their head pro and everybody and the volunteers, thank you very much for a great event. And thank you to Donnie for the invite and the place to stay at probably the best bar in the world, on the river, any way you look.
And that's where we're going to end it tonight. I mean, Mikey, thank you so much, buddy. We'll be back out of here shortly. And cheers to you, my friend.
Sleep good well, my friend. And, you as well. Thank you very much. And everybody, have a good night. Thanks for listening. And don't forget to give us a like. PullHookedOffGolf.com.
And subscribe. Follow us on Apple Podcasts so that you get notified when new episodes come out. Go on to YouTube. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. We put a lot of time and effort into giving you the visual side to this. So even if you're a podcast listener, which is awesome, and obviously this is a podcast. This is meant for listening. But if you get a chance to hop on the YouTube channel, Pull Hook Golf.
And we'll have more golf content with us out there having a good time like we did last time.
Instagram.
That was my fault last time, so it's all good. But Instagram.
Instagram, YouTube, everywhere. I mean, TikTok. We're
send us stuff.
We're doing everything. The one thing that I will say is our Instagram is starting to go on the rise, so definitely take a look at some of the content that's going on there.
And we're doing that on our own.
Some of our reels.
We're doing that on our own.
You know, this is all self-promoted, self-funded.
Yep,
so definitely, if you feel like you like the show, give us a follow, give us a subscribe, and we greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, give us some ideas to talk about, too. Feel free to go on Pull Hook Golf on our Instagram page and give us ideas what to talk about. What do you guys want to talk about? What are your problems with the tour? What is your problem with, what you see, slow play? How long does it take for LPGA chicks? Should it take 2 minutes and 32 seconds to pull the trigger on a putt? No.
Thank you for tuning in to Pull Hook Golf, the podcast. Make sure to hit subscribe and go to www.pullhookgolf.com for more information.